But I want to preach to you this morning. We're going to be in Judges chapter 6, looking at the story of Gideon. And I want to be looking at some lessons that I think that we can draw from the life of this man. And this is one of my favorite stories in the Bible because I, in so many ways, identify with Gideon. And I'm going to show you how here in just a moment. But we are in Judges chapter 6, and I want to lay the foundation for us. In Gideon's day, Israel had no king, and the nation was led by a series of military judicial leaders called judges. And in the days of the judges, we see a pattern repeat itself throughout the book of Judges. Israel would forget their God, and they would fall into sin. And then God would punish Israel, and he would send a foreign invader into the land, and he would oppress the people. And then Israel would remember their God. They would repent, and they would cry out to him, and he would then raise up a leader, a judge, who would liberate Israel, and then they would follow God throughout the life of that judge. But oftentimes, when the judge died, the people would forget again, and the cycle would start all over. So we're in the midst of one of those cycles here in Judges chapter 6. So let me begin reading in Judges chapter 6, starting in verse 1. The people of Israel did what was evil in the sight of the Lord, and the Lord gave them into the hand of Midian 7 years. And the hand of Midian overpowered Israel, and because of Midian, the people of Israel made for themselves the dens that are in the mountains, and the caves and the strongholds. For whenever the Israelites planted crops, the Midianites and the Amalekites and the people of the east would come up against them. They would encamp against them and devour the produce of the land as far as Gaza, and leave no sustenance in Israel, and no sheep or ox or donkey. For they would come up with their livestock and their tents, and they would come like locusts in number. Both they and their camels could not be counted, so that they laid waste the land as they came in. And Israel was brought very low because of Midian. And the people of Israel cried out for help to the Lord. And when the people of Israel cried out to the Lord on account of the Midianites, the Lord sent a prophet to the people of Israel. And he said to them, "Thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, I led you up from Egypt. I brought you out of the house of bondage. I delivered you from the hand of the Egyptians and from the hand of all who oppressed you and drove them out before you and gave you their land. And I said to you, I am the Lord your God, and you shall not fear the gods of the Amorite in whose land you dwell. But you have not obeyed my voice." Now the angel of the Lord came and sat under the terebinth at Ophrah, which belonged to Joash the Abiezrite, while his son Gideon was beating out wheat in the winepress to hide it from the Midianites. And the angel of the Lord appeared to him and said to him, "The Lord is with you, O mighty man of valor." And Gideon said to him, "Please, sir, if the Lord is with us, why then has all this happened to us? And where are all his wonderful deeds that our fathers recounted to us, saying, 'Did not the Lord bring us up from Egypt?' But now the Lord has forsaken us and given us into the hand of Midian." And the Lord turned to him and said, "Go in the might of yours and save Israel from the hand of Midian. Did I not send you?" And he said to him, "Please, Lord, how can I save Israel? Behold, my clan is the weakest in Manasseh, and I am the least in my father's house." The people have sinned. A foreign army has come into the land. They've cried out to God, and he is ready to raise up a leader to liberate Israel. And that man is Gideon. And so God comes to Gideon in verse 12 of this chapter, and the angel says to him, "O mighty man of valor." Well, Gideon's response to this statement is complete disbelief, because he has an overwhelming sense of inferiority. He does not associate himself with the words "mighty man of valor." He says to him in verse 15, "How can I save Israel?" He says, "My clan, that is my extended family, we're the weakest in the whole tribe of Manasseh. And then even in my immediate family, I'm like the runt of the litter. I am the least in my father's house." Gideon felt like there were others who were better suited to this task than he was. He couldn't believe that God had come. He probably wanted to ask the angel, "Are you sure you have the right address? Do you realize this is, I'm Gideon, the son of Joash. I think you're looking for somebody else. You came to the wrong place. I am not the guy you're looking for." And I want us to understand, as Alistair Begg says, it is not as important to be the obvious choice as it is to be God's choice. Because you see, Gideon was not the obvious choice. I want us to understand what he is doing when the angel finds him. It says that he is threshing wheat in a wine press. Now, I know we don't grow a lot of wheat around here, but I grew up in Oklahoma and we have tons of wheat. And the way that you thresh wheat, at least in the old days, is you would take the wheat and you would harvest it. And then you had both the chaff, which is the inedible part of the wheat, and then you've got the grain. And you have to separate the two so that you only have the grain left. And so you need to take the chaff and the wheat and you throw it up in the air and the wind catches it. And the chaff is a lot lighter than the grain, and so the wind would blow it away and the wheat would fall back down. Well, the best place to do this is on top of a hill, somewhere out in the open where you can catch a breeze. Where is Gideon doing this? In a wine press. He's doing this in a hole in the ground. He's basically trying to thresh wheat in a phone booth. Okay, teenagers, when you get home, you can Google what a phone booth is, because I'm sure none of you have ever actually seen one. But he's in a hole in the ground trying to thresh wheat. He is hiding. He says, our people, we're living in rocks in caves. We everything we get, the Midianites take away from us. I'm in a hole in the ground, and you're telling me I'm a mighty man who's going to go out and fight these people. He cannot understand. He cannot believe. He is overwhelmed with a sense of inferiority in where he is at. But we've got to remember that God's ways are not our ways, and his thoughts are not our thoughts. The opinions of men concerning who is and who is not best suited to do something mean very little in the economy of God. And I want you to hear this. God delights in using those who are considered unlikely, unqualified, or inadequate to accomplish his purposes through. And I think that is a huge blessing to me, because when I was growing up, I definitely felt like that. I felt unlikely. I felt unqualified. I felt inadequate. In 2010, my father passed away, and I preached his funeral. That was the first time that many in my family had ever heard me preach. Now, when I was a kid, I was solemn as a judge. I didn't talk. I was bashful, super shy, didn't ever want to engage. I was always afraid if I said something, people would laugh at me. I was a wallflower. And I remember one of my aunts came up to me at the end of the funeral, and she was laughing. She said, you know, I've never heard you preach, but I remember when you were in high school and your mom told us that you felt like God was calling you to preach, I remember asking him, Jason understands he's going to have to talk to people a lot if he's going to be a pastor. How is this going to work? Because I was not a likely candidate. I was very bashful. I was very insecure. But God loves to choose that which is unlikely, because you see, it's not about us. It's all about him. And the rest of chapter 6 deals with Gideon struggling to come to terms with the call that the Lord has placed on his life. And there's the story about him cutting down a pagan shrine. There's a story about him and a fleece. But I want to jump on to the next chapter, Judges chapter 7. And let me read beginning in verse 1. Then Jerub-Baal, by the way, if you're looking for a good name for your baby, don't use that one. Jerub-Baal, that is Gideon. And all the people who were with him rose early and encamped beside the spring of Harod. And the camp of Midian was north of them by the hill of Morah in the valley. And the Lord said to Gideon, the people with you are too many for me to give the Midianites into their hand, lest Israel boast over me, saying, my own hand has saved me. Now therefore, proclaim in the ears of the people, saying, whoever is fearful and trembling, let him return home and hurry away from Mount Gilead. Then 22,000 of the people returned and 10,000 remained. So Gideon puts out the call for the men of Israel to rally to fight the invaders. And remember, the Bible in Judges 6 verse 5 says that they were like locusts without numbers. They were beyond number. There were so many that they couldn't even number them. And when they gather, Gideon looks around and he discovers that he has 32,000 men. Now, the Bible doesn't record Gideon's reaction, but I believe we can use our holy imagination here. If it had been me, the thought going through my mind when we get 32,000 men together is I would have been like, we need more. They have a number that cannot be counted. We only have 32,000, and we need to find more men before we go to battle. But God shows up, and guess what he tells Gideon? tells Gideon the exact opposite. The people with you are too many for me to give the Midianites into your hand. And Gideon is probably thinking, you've got to be kidding me. What? They're a vast horde. They cannot be numbered. And God is saying 32,000 men is too many? And God goes on to give his reasoning. He says, I want you to send, he says this, lest Israel boast over me, saying my own hand has saved me. You see, God was concerned that even as unlikely as it may have been, Israel with 32,000 men, if they had defeated the Midianites, they still could have believed that they had accomplished this, that they had won this victory through their military prowess. But you see, God will not share his glory with anyone. And he knew that with 32,000 men, as unlikely a victory as it would have been, Israel would still believe that it was their own effort that they had won this battle, and they would take credit for God's work. You see, God does not share his glory, and he's looking for those who are willing to give him the glory, that are not in it for their own edification and their own advancement. They're saying, I am here for God and him alone. And again, Scripture doesn't tell us what Gideon was thinking, but he probably thought only, this is crazy. And so he tells them, he goes, listen, if any of you are scared or afraid to fight, go home. And I'm sure he closed his eyes and like, please, Lord, let them all be there when I open. And turns around, two-thirds of them had taken off. He's now down to 10,000 men. So the principle is God is not concerned with the victory. That's not a problem for God. God can rout 10,000 with one. God's problem is not the victory. He is concerned with securing the glory for the victory for himself, because God is God and we are not. And therefore, when we steal God's glory, we take that which does not belong to us. So I want to continue on in the story. We're in verse 4. And the Lord said to Gideon, the people are still too many. Really? Take them down to the water, and I will test them there for you. And anyone of whom I say, this one shall go with you, shall go. And anyone of whom I say, this one shall not go with you, shall not go. So he brought them, the people, down to the water. And the Lord said to Gideon, everyone who laps the water with his tongue as a dog laps, you shall let sit by himself. Likewise, everyone who kneels down to drink. And the number of those who lapped, putting their mouth to their hands, was 300 men, but all the rest of the people knelt down to drink water. And the Lord said to Gideon, with the 300 who laughed, I will save you and give the Midianites into your hand. Let all the others go, every man to his home. So the people took provisions in their hands and their trumpets, and he set all the rest of Israel, every man to his tent, but retained the 300, and the camp of Midian was below him in the valley. So God still tells Gideon, you still have too many men. Even 10,000 is too many. And I don't know about you, but my reaction would have been, you've got to be kidding me. They are a vast horde that cannot be numbered. We need more than that. But God tells him to take these men down to a spring and separate them based on how they drink water. Now, the Hebrew isn't really clear. We don't know exactly what went on here. All we know is that 97% of them drank one way, 3% drank another. And God chose the 3%. And a lot's been made about the difference in what was going on here. We don't really know. All we know is that 3% was special. We just don't know if they were special forces special or special special. You know what I'm saying? We don't know if they were crack troops or a bunch of crack pots. All we know is that God went with the tiny fraction who did something very different. He said, that's your group. That's your men. The point was that God was going to use a ridiculously small group of men to accomplish his purpose. Now, at this point, if 300 can defeat this vast horde, nobody anywhere is going to think that this was Gideon. They're not going to think it was these men. They are going to know that somehow God showed up and did something miraculous here. God is now in a place where no one is going to give his glory to anyone else. But I want us to see that Gideon is still nervous. After all of this, after all these things that God has done to confirm, he still is not sure. And in verse 9 we read, that same night the Lord said to him, arise, go down against the camp, for I have given it into your hand. But if you're afraid to go down to the camp with Purah your servant. And you shall hear what they say, and afterward your hands shall be strengthened to go down against the camp. Then he went down with Kirah, his servant, to the outpost of the armed men who were in the camp. And the Midianites and the Amalekites and all the people of the east lay along the valley like locusts in abundance. Again, can't even count them. Their camels were without number, as the sand that is on the seashore in abundance. And when Gideon came, behold, a man was telling a dream to his comrade. And he said, "Behold, I dreamed a dream, and behold, a cake of barley bread tumbled into the camp of Midian and came to the tent and struck it so that it fell, and it turned it upside down so that the tent lay flat." And his comrade answered, "This is no other than the sword of Gideon, the son of Joash, the man of Israel. God has given into his hand Midian and all the camp." And as soon as Gideon heard the telling of the dream and its interpretation, he worshipped. God had told Gideon he was going to win victory through him, but Gideon still had doubts. So God tells him to sneak down into the Midianite camp that night, and he overhears this conversation between these two Midianite soldiers. And in that conversation, he removes all doubt from Gideon's mind. As Alistair Begg says, God showed Gideon that not only is he sovereign in the camp of Israel, he is also sovereign in the camp of Midian. And I think that's a word that we need to remember today. We live in a culture that seems to become increasingly hostile to our faith. We look around and you can watch, don't watch the news, it's just going to scare you. There's just craziness going on. And sometimes we wonder, God, are you still in control? We're like Gideon sometimes. We think maybe he's abandoned us. He's left us. Where are you, God? But I want you to remember, God is still on his throne. He is still God. We have no reason to fear. We may be in the minority. We may only be 3% against a horde, but God can still accomplish his purposes through us. So we don't need to fear. We don't need to be afraid. God can even overturn a vast horde who are against us and still bring the victory. So let's put our faith in him. Let's trust him. We don't have to have all the answers. We don't have to know how this is all going to begin, how this is all going to end. We just have to know that God is in control. See, God doesn't share with us how it all works out, because if God shared every detail with you, guess what you don't need at that point? You don't need faith. If you knew how it was all going to happen, if you've read the whole story, you knew what's going to happen next, there's no drama. How many of you have ever watched a movie that you've already read the book? The movie loses a lot, right? Because you know what's going to happen. So in those suspenseful moments, you're like, I know how this is going to work. Yeah, it's not a big deal. God doesn't, because if we live that way, there's no place for faith. God wants us to trust and depend on him step by step, day by day. And so at moments, it looks dark. At moments, we wonder what's going to happen. But God is still in control. And let's continue and finish our story here. So the second half of verse 15, "And he returned to the camp of Israel," that is Gideon, "and said, 'Arise, for the Lord has given the host of Midian into your hand.' And he divided the 300 men into three companies and put trumpets into their hands, and all of them, and empty jars with torches inside the jars. And he said to them, 'Look at me and do likewise. When I come to the outskirts of the camp, do as I do. When I blow the trumpet, I and all who are with me, then blow the trumpets also on every side of all the camp and shout for the Lord and for Gideon.' So Gideon and the 100 men who were with him came to the outskirts of the camp at the beginning of the middle watch, that is midnight, when they had just set the watch. And they blew the trumpets and they smashed the jars that were in their hands. Then the three companies blew the trumpets and broke the jars. They held in their left hands the torches and in their right hands the trumpets to blow. And they cried out, 'A sword for the Lord and for Gideon.' And every man stood in his place around the camp, and all the army ran. They cried out and fled. And when they blew the 300 trumpets, the Lord set every man's sword," that is in the Amalekite, the Midianite camp, "every man's sword against his comrade and against all the army. And the army flew as far as Beth Shittah toward Zerorah, as far as the border of Abel Meholah by Tabath. And the name and the men of the Israel were called out from Naphtali and from Asher and from all Manasseh, and they pursued after Midian." So Gideon returns to the camp. He now is a believer. He knows that God has given him the victory. And he comes and he lays before his men a plan of attack that could be called unconventional. My pastor back in St. Louis, he was a graduate of the United States Army Academy. He's a West Point grad. And I'm fairly certain that if Daniel had ever submitted a battle plan that looked anything like Gideon's, they would have probably kicked him out of West Point, said, "You're nuts, dude. I mean, seriously, you're going to blow horns and wave flashlights. That's your plan of attack." And if I'd been in the camp with Gideon and he'd come back and he'd said, "This is what we're doing," I'd been like, "Are you drunk? I mean, are you on? This is the dumbest thing I've ever heard of. You're going to get us all killed. This is stupid to stand there, blow horns, and wave flashlights. That's your plan of attack." But that's what God had told. And listen, the reason that it was going to work is that it was God's plan. Gideon isn't out here freelancing. This is a plan that God had given to him. Now, if Gideon had come up with his own plan on his own, that plan probably would have gotten them all killed. But you see, this is God's plan. And sometimes God asks us to do things that we don't think make sense. But you see, God doesn't operate on human reason. He doesn't operate by our standards of logic. Remember, God's ways are not our ways. His thoughts are not our thoughts. And so he says, "This is what we're going to do." And at this point, this plan was so crazy that neither Gideon, nor his men, nor anyone in Israel, nor anyone anywhere could come to any other conclusion than that God did this. This wasn't Gideon. God showed up in a powerful way. And until we are willing to allow God to put us in situations that are seemingly impossible and obediently follow him, even when it doesn't make sense, we will never see God move in a mighty way. If you limit God by what you think is reasonable, if you limit God by what your logic thinks can happen, God simply cannot use you. And many of us feel like Gideon. We don't feel like God can use us because we don't feel adequate. We feel like we're nobody. We feel like we don't have the skills. We don't feel like we have the abilities. Listen, that's poppycock. God can and God will use anyone. He used a donkey to speak through. He can use any one of us. God is in the business of using the unlikely, and he will only use us if we allow him to put us in places where the unlikely is all that can happen. And in the end, I want you to notice this. How much fighting did Gideon and his men actually have to do? None. The Midianites turned on themselves. God showed up and he fought the battle for Gideon and his men. All Gideon and his men had to do was go down and clean up the mess. They had to round up the stragglers and collect all the booty. God brought the victory. And God will fight for us if we will faithfully follow him and be obedient to what he's called us to do. He promises to bless us. And I want to challenge you this morning. Don't ever tell God, "I can't do that. God, you can't. I'm not worthy. I'm not able." That's baloney. You are able, because you plus God is enough. In fact, it is more than enough. He can fill up any inadequacy you have. He can fill up anything that you're lacking. All he is looking for is not someone who has tons of ability, but someone who has availability. Are you willing to let God use you? Let Gideon be an example to us that God is in the business of using the unlikely to accomplish the unlikely if we will only trust him and let him work in our life. Father, we come to you this morning and we thank you for your word. We thank you for the truth that we don't have to have it all together. We don't have to be big and mighty. We don't have to be grand. We don't have to have all of the answers. You're just looking for someone who is willing to surrender, willing to say, "Use me," willing to say, "Father, my life is in your hands. I give myself to you. Use me as you see fit. My life is yours."